Hey everyone, ahlan sahlan fikum. Welcome back to another video about Palestinian Arabic. Today we're going to talk about the very last verb conjugation, which is going to be the imperative. So we've talked about the past tense and the present tense. And the cool thing is that actually in Arabic, as far as verb conjugations go, those are all the three that you have. You just have the past tense, the present tense, and the imperative. So the imperative is to give orders. So like when you say, do this, do that. And in Arabic, it really follows pretty naturally from the present tense. It's pretty much like a variation of the present tense in the way that you form it. So I don't think this is going to be too hard at all, fortunately. And then after that, we're going to talk about the last two root types that we have, C and D. Again, this is from the typology that I kind of designed. We're going to talk about what those look like in form one, but then you'll have that knowledge when we go forward and talk about forms two, three, you know, whatever, because they sort of function in the same way across all those verb forms. So I think that this is going to be a pretty important video, but with the last two videos that I did about the past tense and the present tense and this one, I think we'll have covered all of the really important bases as far as the Arabic verb. Then we just have to talk about the different forms, but those are going to be really strongly based on these videos. So without further ado, let's get started. So as for the imperative, okay, so again, this is to give orders, right? And the way that you form this in Arabic is very simple. Again, we're just taking form one as our base because that's what we've talked about until now. Basically, what you do to form the imperative is you take the present tense of the third person, so huwa, you take the present tense, and basically all you do is you remove the bab, which is the sort of initial sort of prefix for all of the present tense verbs. So you take the bab away, but you leave the short vowel, and then that's your imperative. So let's do some examples because that was a very fast explanation. So let's take a verb like kasar. Okay, so kasar is form A1. You know, if you want to review what all of that means, that's in the previous videos. So kasar is form A1. So in the present, for huwa biksir, right? Now, to make the imperative for kasar, all you do is you take the present tense, biksir, and then you remove the bab, but you keep the I, right, of biksir. So you keep that, and then the imperative for kasar is iksir. So that means break, so break it. I don't know, I mean, if you wanted to say that. So let's start with that. There's your imperative. Now, there's three forms for the imperative, kind of. I mean, there's three conjugations for it. You can say either you male do something, you female do something, so enta, enti, and then entu, so you plural do something. Actually, it's really simple to switch between because all you do is you add ye for female and you add wow for plural. So if I wanted to say iksir, okay, so that's you male, enta, but iksiri is you female, enti, break. And iksiru is you plural. So anytime that I want to talk like to all of you do something, I just add well, and if it's female, just add yeah. But really, those are the three forms and it's really easy to switch between, so that's great. Now, the same basic principle applies across all the forms that we've talked about. A1, A2, you know, blah, blah, blah. So let's do some examples with some of the different ones. So we have the AA verbs, so the ones that are fatha in the past, but also fatha in the present. Again, a review of that is in the previous video about the present tense and the past tense. So if I have a verb like mazah, in the present, that's bimzah for huwa. Huwa bimzah, so he jokes. So if I want to do the imperative for this, again, I just take away the bab, and I get a sort of alif with hamza, I guess, with kasra. So that would be imzah, right? So it's the same as bimzah, but it's just imzah instead of bimzah. What about a verb like katab? Okay, this one is a little tricky. I mean, there's just something that you have to remember. So katab, in the present tense, it takes dhamma. So it's the A-W verb. So if I wanted to say I write, it would be ana baktob. But here's the thing. I forgot now if I mentioned this in some of the other videos, so take note of this. These AW verbs, these ones that take dhamma in the present, they're the only verbs like ever at all, at least na'miyya, that also put that dhamma on the yeah for huwa. So here's the thing, if you actually wrote out the verb biksir, like fully, the thing is you could argue that there's actually a sort of hidden yeah that sort of just got smushed together. So instead of having biyiksir, which is kind of redundant, you just have biksir. But if you look at it that way, right, that yeah has kasra on it. So it's biyiksir, I guess, and that's why it's shortened to biksir. But the thing is, only for these aw verbs, the ones that take dhamma in the present, they also take dhamma on the yeah, on that sort of hidden yeah. So once that gets smushed together, it looks like buktub. So huwa buktub, it's not huwa biktub, right? And if you were to write it down fully, it would be biyuktub, I guess. So that hidden yeah is taking a dhamma in the present tense. And this is the only type of verb that ever does this. So just make a note of that. And why am I saying that? That's because in the imperative, that really comes in. Because if you take out the ba for buktub, you take out the ba and you get uktub. So for the aw verbs, they're quite unique actually in this regard, where in the imperative, so instead of having alif with kasra, so iksir, you have uktub. So you start with an o sound. That's pretty unique actually. That's the only place where you'll ever see that. What about an A2 verb? Well, it's simple, it's the same thing. If you have ribah, in the present tense, it's huwa birbah, right? So in the imperative, it's just going to be that, but without the beb. So it's going to be irbah. So the last two that we've covered so far, the last two sort of forms within form one, are B1 and B2, which are missing that last letter. I talked about that in the previous episode. So with regards to the imperative, it pretty much follows the same pattern, the same principles as what we've just talked about. But you just have to pay attention to how the last letter behaves, that ya or alif maksura, because it will change things just a little bit. So let's do the example of haka. So haka means to speak, and the imperative, well, the present tense, it's huwa bihki, right? Because the alif maksura switched into a ya. So huwa bihki. Now if I take away the bab, the imperative is ihki. So speak, talk. Ihki. Now, because the ya is already there, the thing to note here is that if you wanted to say it to enti, well, the ya is already there, so it's just going to be ihki. That's really what you need to be aware of, that there's no change in that regard. And then if I wanted to speak to a group, ihku. So the wow replaces the ya or the alif maksura or whatever, which is something that we talked about in the last video, that in general, like if you speak in the plural, the wow is going to replace that last letter. Now for B2, if you have the verb nisi, well, in the present tense, that's binsa. So huwa binsa. Now if you take away the bab, well, what do you get? Insa. Insa means forget. And actually, it's a common expression. If you just say insa, like forget it, never mind, you know, insa. So that's, you see, we're already getting some applications out of this. Of course, insa, if I wanted to talk to a girl, it would be insi. And if I wanted to speak to a group, insu. So in this case, the ya and the wow do sort of affect things, whereas in a B1 verb, it's really just going to affect the plural because the ya is already there for enti. So there's no change there. All right, so let's review. You have kasar, biksir, iksir. You have mazah, bimzah, imzah. You have katab, boktob, oktob. You have ribih, birbah, irbah. You have bihki, ihki. And you have nisi, binsa, insa. And of course, you know, put the ya and put the wow wherever that's needed. All right, so that's the imperative. So what we wanna do next is we're gonna talk about verbs that have root types C and D. Now this is important because even though I'm gonna talk about them in relation to form one, which is what we've been talking about until now, the same principles basically apply across the board in all of the other forms. So this is pretty important. And then once I introduce what these verb forms are, we're gonna talk about what they are in the present tense, the past tense, and the imperative now that we've learned the imperative. Okay, so we already talked about root forms A and B. A is where all the letters are present. B is where the last letter of the root is missing. As we'll talk about later, D is the type where the middle letter of the root is missing. But type C is the type that has the same letter for the last two letters of the root. Again, this is the typology that I created, so if you Google like form C or whatever, that's not gonna come up, but it's just something that that I use to sort of organize all the different types, because otherwise it's chaotic. So anyway, because you have the same letter for the last two letters of the root, you get something that's called gemination. Now, gemination is sort of the repetition, I guess you could say, of the same letter. They kind of get fused, and then you put a shadda. So if you have the root, for example, ha ba ba, this is the root with the meaning of love. But if you actually want the word for love, you fuse the last two letters, you combine them, and you add a shadda. So that sounds like ho. So it seems like there's only two letters, but there's actually three. It's just that the two B's got combined with the shadda. So let's talk about this as a verb. Okay, so how do I say, like, I love you, or I love chicken, whatever. Okay, so the verb with love is hab. Okay, so that means to love, but specifically, as you know, it's the sort of base form of the verb, which is him in the past tense. So hab means he loved. Now this is what I call form CY. Okay, why do I call it CY? So I've been talking about A1, A2, B1, B2, etc. So why is this CY? It seems kind of weird, right? So the thing is that in Form 1, with root types C and D, each one also has two forms, but the thing is that it's not for the same reasons that you have 1 and 2. It's actually simpler than you think. So there's a reason, actually, that I have been talking about A1 and A2, and there's a reason that A1 is the first one and A2 is the secondary one. So A1 verbs are the ones that have fatha fatha in the past tense, so is AW and AA and all that stuff, and B1 for that matter. So the thing is that these are labeled 1 in my typology because actually having fatha in the past tense is pretty much standard across all the verb forms. In fact, A2 and B2, those are the only types of verbs at all in Arabic, at least as far as I know in Ammiya, that have kasra in the past tense. For example, fihim and nisi, etc. Those are the only ones that have kasra in the past tense. All the other ones have fatha in the past tense. That's why I say that the sort of standard is A1 and B1. And actually, the most standard thing, by the way, this is actually really, really important to remember because you will see it across all the other forms. This is really useful to know. In the past tense, the standard is having fatha fatha, and in the present tense, across all the other forms, except for form one with these different types that we're talking about, across all the other forms, it's always going to be kasra in the present tense, whereas in the past tense, it's going to be fatha. Now, the reason that I'm saying this is because for types C, Y, and DY, and as we'll talk about, CW and DW, what's different is not in the past tense at all. In fact, in the past tense, these verbs look basically the same. So then you might ask, okay, so what is CY? You know, what makes it Y? And what makes it different from the other type of C verbs in Form 1, right? Which is CW. Now you might have caught on to the fact that you have CY and CW. The Y and the W are actually indicating a vowel, right? So Y being an I, or, you know, kasra or ye, and W referring to like dhamma or wow. So what does this all look like? Okay, so with the verb hab, okay, so hab is the past tense. As we can see, there's fatha, as is going to be common across the board, as I just said. Now in the present tense, that's why it's CY. So in the present tense, the vowel that it's going to have, the short vowel, is going to be kasra. Okay, so if I want to say he loved, it's huwa hab. But if I want to put that in the present tense, it follows the same rules as everything else that we've talked about. So I add the ba and the kasra for him, so bi. Now I take the verb hab, and all I do is I switch that fatha for a kasra. And that's what makes it CY, and that's what makes it the present tense. So bihab. So huwa bihab. Ana bihab. So here it's ana ba hab. So the kasra is what makes it the present tense, because it's a CY verb. Okay, I will give you all the conjugations for all that in a second, because right now I just want to compare it first with CW. So what makes a verb a CW verb? There's really a very, very slight difference between CW and CY, because all it means is that in the present tense, CY, like hab, is going to be bahab with kasra, and CW verbs like hat. So hat means to put, In the present tense, this is not going to take kasra, but it's going to take a dhamma instead. So it's going to be huwa bihut. See, so instead of being bihit, it's bihut with a dhamma. But really, that's the only significant difference between these two verbs, hab and hat. Whereas in the past tense, they look exactly the same. In the present tense, they have this different vowel. Now let's do these two in the present tense, and I'll just go down the line with both of them, so you can see how they're basically the same except for that little vowel. Okay, so ana bahab, ana bahut, anta bithab, anta bithut, anti bithabbi, anti bithutti, huwa bihab, huwa bihut, hiya bithab, hiya bithut, احنا منحب احنا منحط انتو بتحبوا انتو بتحطوا هم بحبوا هم بحطوا. So I just want to make a little note here. I think I've heard some people use حب instead of a CY verb as a CW verb. I think this particular verb can be used as either. I think I've heard بحبك as, which means I love you, instead of بحبك, which is what I say. But I think both are fine, but usually a verb is one or the other. It just happens that this, I've heard it used as both, but normally it's one or the other. Okay, so that's the difference between CY verbs and CW verbs. As you can see, it's pretty much the same principle. The only difference is the short vowel in the present tense. Okay, now let's do these in the past tense. Now I'm gonna do them together again because, as I said before, they're literally exactly the same in the present tense in terms of their forms. Let's start with the third person forms though, because there's something slightly different that happens with the rest of the conjugations. So let's start with the basic third person. So huwa, huwa hab, and huwa hat, right? Now for hiya, all we're gonna do is we're gonna add that at ending. So it's going to be habbat and hattat, right? So this means she loved or she put. Now remember that there's gemination going on. So that b, that shadda on the b, maybe it's not really pronounced for hab because there's really nothing to go after it, so you don't really hear that emphasis that much. But with habbat, it's definitely audible. So just remember that that's there. Now for the plural, again, all we're gonna do is add the waw. So it's going to be humme habbu and humme hattu, right? Again, remember the emphasis on the b. Now the only thing here that's different for all the other ones, I don't know if it's because of the gemination or exactly why it has to be this way, but it's going to be the same as the B verbs, where you have a sort of long, sort of extended E sound before the actual T that usually indicates the past tense. So what does that look like? So if I want to say I loved, it's not just habbat, because habbat is for hiye. Instead it's going to be ana habbeit. So there's this long sort of E sound. And yeah, I guess it's tied to the gemination of the B. It's sort of, I don't know, that's just the effect that it has. So it's ana habbeit, ana hatteit, okay? Anta habbeit, anta hatteit, okay? Anti habbeiti, anti hatteiti. Then we did huwa, hiya, okay? Ehna habbeina, ehna hatteina. Okay, so same thing with the E, sort of the ya, and the na. Entu habbeitu, entu hatteitu, and then we did hum. So that's it. Those are all the forms in the present tense and in the past tense for C type roots in form one. And as we can see, the difference between CY and CW, not very big, only in the present tense. Now we can talk about D. Okay, so D type roots in form one are my favorite, actually. I don't know why, but they are characterized by this missing letter in the middle. Now this missing letter is going to be replaced, I guess, by a vowel, be it alif, ya, or waw. Now in the past tense, it's always going to be alif. So it kind of goes, sort of dovetails with the fact that the past tense verbs, as I've mentioned, the standard type is to always have fatha, however many fathas, to have fatha in the past tense. Only A2 and B2 are the only ones where you actually have kasra in the past tense. But across the board, it's always going to be fatha, or in this case, alif in the past tense. So let's take an example of what I call a DY verb. So that might tip you off a little bit on why it's DY and why it's DW, which is the other type for D, because it does relate to the vowel. Okay, so DY, a DY verb is jeb, for example. So jeb is the past tense. As we can see, there's just an alif, nice sort of just two letters and then alif in the middle. Now in the present tense, guess what happens to this alif? Okay, so since it's DY, the alif turns into a ya. So it transforms into another vowel. So because alif is always the past tense vowel, in this case, what's gonna happen is it's going to turn into a ya, and it's going to sound like ana, for example, ana bajib. So huwa jab in the past tense, huwa bajib in the present tense. Ana bajib, you know, anta bajib, etc., etc. Now, how does that differ from DW? Okay, so DW verbs are the ones that instead of taking ya in the present tense, they take a waw. It works exactly the same way. The only difference is that you have, instead of ya, you have waw. So an example of this is chef. Again, remember that in the past tense, they always have alif. So chef, jab, you're really not gonna know what vowel it's going to take in the present tense if you just look at the past tense, unfortunately. There's no way of knowing. So you just have to ask or whatever. Actually, this is kind of a little bit of a self plug, but you know, you can find it sometimes online, like Wiktionary or whatever. You know, if you look up a verb in the past tense, you can see it how it would be in the present tense, and then you can know if it's, you know, if it's gonna take a yeah or if it's gonna take a wow. But I've been mentioning this in my video descriptions, but I have a spreadsheet with like over 600 like of the most common verbs for ammiya. It's what I use to learn. Really, I sort of have been working on this spreadsheet since I started learning Arabic, and now it has all of the different verb types, all this stuff that I'm talking about in the video, it's all in the spreadsheet. They're all identified by A1, B1, etc., 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 C, W, etc. So if you're ever wondering, I mean, that spreadsheet is there. There's a link to it in the video description. So that has all of that, and you can benefit from that. Anyway, again, in the past tense, these are the same. You have jab and you have chef. In the present tense, though, one, DY, is bajib, and the other one is DW, it's bashuf. So I see is ana bashuf, because chef means to see. So let's actually conjugate all of those in the present tense, the DY and the DW verb. So ana bajib, ana bashuf, anta bajib, anta bashuf, anti bajibi, anti bashufi, huwa bajib, huwa bashuf, hiya bajib, hiya bashuf, ahna minjib, ahna minshuf, antu bajibu, antu bashufu, humme bajibu, humme bashufu. And that's it. I mean, again, the present tense, I mean, it's all the same stuff that we've spoken about so far. I mean, in the future, I don't even think I'm going to do all the different conjugations because it's exactly the same. The only thing that you have to know about these verbs is the ya or the waw. And for C, Y, and CW, the kasra or the dhamma. Now for the past tense, let's start again with the third person, unless you both of these. So huwa jab, huwa shaf. Hiya jabat, hiya shafat. Again, just the at for hiya. Humme jabu, humme shafu. The thing is, for the rest of the ones that are not the third person, there's a little bit of a special thing going on, again. But it's not like the C verbs. Actually, here there is a difference between DY verbs and DW verbs. Because what's gonna happen here is that the A is going to be pulled out and it's going to be replaced with a short vowel. But that short vowel is actually gonna be what the vowel would be in the present tense. So this is actually pretty unique because this means that, unfortunately, I guess, I mean, it doesn't follow the principle of always having alif in the past tense. It does in the third person, but for the rest, you're going to use the vowel that you use in the present tense, which is either going to be ya or kasra or waw or dhamma. So in the case of jab, so in the present, it's bajib, I bring. But the past tense of I brought, so the long vowel goes out, you're gonna turn it into a short vowel, and that short vowel is going to be kasra, because it's ya in the present tense, ana bajib. So, and then you add the t. So it's going to be ana jibit. See, it's ana jibit. The a comes out and it becomes the kasra. It's kind of like bajib, ana jibit, but the thing is that the long vowel of ya has turned into a short vowel, which is kasra. And it's the same principle for the DW verbs. So instead of ana bashuf, it's ana shufit. You see? So you just sort of shorten that vowel. And that's going to be the pattern for the rest of the non-third person conjugations. So let's do both of those. Ana jibit, ana shufit. Enta jibit, enta shufit. Enti jibti, enti shufti. We have huwa, we have hiya. Ehna jibna. Ehna shufna, entu jibtu, entu shuftu. And then homme we already did also. Okay, so that's basically it. Those are all the present tense and past tense conjugations of the CY, CW, DY, and DW verbs. Again, the only difference is with regards to what vowel it's going to take in the present tense, whether it's short or long, depending on if it's C or D. And really, that's it. I hope that has been a straightforward explanation. The last thing that we want to do is just put those in the imperative. But that's just going to take really a second. Because as I said before, the imperative is basically the present tense, but without the bab in the beginning. Actually, we can take it farther than that, because that's mainly true for form one in the A and B, with the A and B type roots. But actually for the rest of the forms and for form one with root types C and D, so these verbs that we've talked about until now, actually you don't even do the initial vowel. So let's just do an example of that. So you have hab, so huwa bihab. In the imperative, you just take out the b and all the vowel and just everything before the actual sort of root of the verb altogether. So it's just hib. Now, I don't know if that would be very common to say, love. I mean, sure, I guess. So that would be hib. And if I wanted to say something that's more common to say, if I want to say put, it would be hot. Now, careful here, because remember that this is based on the present tense. So even though it kind of looks like the past tense, because you don't have any B's and you don't have anything, so if you didn't put any of the vowels, hat really does look like hot, but hat is the past tense and hot is the imperative, because it's based on bihot. It's just that you took out the bit, you know? So you just get hot, and that's the imperative. No alif in the beginning or anything. Now, same principle is going to apply for the D verbs. So the D verbs, let's take jab. So jab in the present tense, it's bijib. But in the imperative, it's just jib. And likewise, chef in the present tense, bishuv, huwa bishuv. Enta, shuv. That's super, super common to say. Shuv, shuv. That means look. And of course, you know, add the ya or add the wow for feminine or for plural. So shufi, shufu, jibu, jibi, etc. All that's the same. Just note again that it's based on the present tense. The imperative is exactly the same as the present tense. It's just without the bab and without the vowel. Whereas with root types A and B, you do keep the vowel because you have this like alif, so iksir or oktob or ihki, etc. But in this case, you don't have that alif at all. You just have hot, you just have shuf, etc. So that's it. That's all we want to talk about. You should congratulate yourself because that covers all of the verb conjugations in Arabic ever, forever, of all time. Because all you have is the past tense, the present tense, and the imperative. That is really it. We'll talk about some other stuff in the future, but they're not really verb conjugations that change depending on the person or anything. So we'll talk about things, but it won't be like this. This is really the foundation of Arabic verbs, especially form one, which is really the sort of plurality of verbs that you're ever going to use. So we talked about that in the four different root types, the main ones, A, B, C, and D. Now we've covered all that. We've covered imperative, past tense, present tense. And all we have left is to talk about forms 2 and 10, which sounds like a lot, but actually, now that we've covered all this, like, I'm gonna do like many forms in one video because it'll really just take a minute, because all of the principles that we've talked about until now are going to apply the same across the board. All right, this has been a long video, so congratulate yourself, have a cup of tea, I don't know, whatever, and relax, and I'll see you next time.